Hello and welcome to EPG Pathshala. Today we'll be dealing with paper Introduction to Linguistics and its module number 19 titled The Modularity of Mind Part 2. To give you an outline about what all we'll be covering in this module, we'll be starting off with the grammar of vision and its neural correlates. From this, we'll move on to the Fodorian encapsulation of modules, his dichotomy between horizontal and vertical faculties, difference between propositional knowledge and the processing systems, and input systems as modules along with their characteristics, like input systems are domain specific, how operations of input systems are mandatory, how there's only limited central access to the mental representations that input systems compute, and also informational encapsulation of the information systems. To begin with, we saw in the previous unit that Chomsky had an idea of the modularity of mind. In this, various cognitive modules talked to each other. For example, linguistic competence, which was a mental module that comprises knowledge of language and its instantiation in use, that was the linguistic performance, involved two other faculties of mind, memory and common sense knowledge of the world. In this unit, we'll be dealing with a slightly different notion of modularity, which was given primarily by the psychologist and psycholinguist Jerry Fodor. To begin with, we'll be dealing with vision. Vision is a mental module. It is the most well-investigated property of mind after language faculty. To talk about the grammar of vision and its neural correlates, we know that unlike language, vision is not unique to human beings. As a result, experimentation was possible on other organisms in the world. Interspecies differences do exist in the visual mechanisms, but we were able to uncover the basic physical mechanisms that underlie vision. To provide you some information about what research on frogs provided us with, there are specific neurons in the visual cortex of a frog that detect movement. And to quote Chomsky 1988, the eye of a frog is designed, in effect, to see a fly in motion. If there is a certain kind of motion, the eye brain will see it. But a dead fly placed in the line of sight will not trigger the visual mechanism and will not be seen. And what did the research on cats provide us? That there are certain neurons that respond selectively to horizontal or vertical stimuli. To see this, selective deprivation was done on kittens for horizontal or vertical stimuli by excluding these stimuli from their environment. This selective deprivation led to atrophy of the corresponding newborns. To give you an insight into how this was done, newborn kittens had their one eye covered and goggles were provided on the other eye for about 3 hours a day. And these goggles only showed them one kind of stimulus, either horizontal or vertical bars. This suggests that there exists a critical period during the maturation of an organism which is required for proper growth of the vision faculty. And there is also a need for triggering experience of the appropriate sort in the early infancy of an organism. Chomsky 1988 states that the visual system is unlike the language of faculty in many crucial ways. It does not yield a system of knowledge, for example, but it is strictly a processing system. But the human visual system observes certain principles just as the language faculty does. These principles might be regarded as in some sense comparable to the principles of language faculty. They are, of course, entirely different principles. The two systems operate in quite different ways, not surprisingly. Now, how does watching television and the Fodorian encapsulation of module are related to each other? To see this, let's begin with propositional knowledge and processing systems. Chomsky acknowledged a difference between the visual faculty and the faculty of language. For him, the faculty of language comprised of a body of knowledge of propositions of nature of language, whereas the faculty of vision is a strictly processing system. Jerry Fodor's discussion on innateness and modularity points to precisely this kind of difference. Chomsky revived the claim of innate ideas, and the innate ideas was originally propounded by Descartes. Chomskyan's claims are therefore referred to as neo-Cartesian claims. Fodor tells us in his 1983 work that the essence of the neo-Cartesian style in psychology is to assume that mental structure should be explicated largely by reference to the propositional contents of mental states. Besides this, there may be other kinds of innate mental structures too, for example, memory. Now, memory isn't a faculty in the neo-Cartesian sense of that notion. Having a memory isn't a matter of having one or another set of beliefs. Memory is, as one supposes, some sort of mechanism analogous to a hand or a liver or a heart. Fodor cites the example of George Miller's famous paper, The Magical Number 7 Plus or Minus 2, to make his point about memory clearer. In this 1956 paper, Miller has argued that there is a fairly constant limit, namely that of 7 plus or minus 2, on the immediate recall of unrelated, unfamiliar terms, such as a string of random numbers, a string of random things in a list. These limits on the capacity for immediate recall are fairly constant across people. They seem to be a part of how memory is structured and it operates. Fodor remarks, the sort of treatment that Miller's data cries out for is not the postulation of an innately cognized rule, but rather of a psychological mechanism, a piece of hardware, one might say, whose structure somehow imposes limitations upon its capacities. Thus, Fodor distinguishes between two types of mental modules. The first one that embody a knowledge of language in the neo-Cartesian sense, such as knowledge of language, of geometrical space, or metaphysics. The second type of mental module includes modules that are processing systems, whose content is not a body of propositional knowledge. For example, modules like vision or memory. It's important to note that limits on immediate memory can be increased by allowing an internal structure to the 5 to 9 ranging items. A sentence longer than 9 words in length can be remembered because it has internal structure. Words of sentences can be grouped into subjects and predicates, which have hierarchical structure within themselves too. One function of then hierarchical structure could be to group stimuli in ways that aid their processing in immediate memory. Larger strings of random numbers, such as telephone numbers and numerical codes, can be recalled by imposing a simple structure on them, such as a rhythmic structure. For example, an 8-digit telephone number may be grouped into 2 4-digit parts and hence can be recalled easily. Now let's move on to our next topic, horizontal and vertical faculties. Fodor distinguished between two kinds of possible functional architectures for mental faculties, namely horizontal faculties and vertical faculties. Now this horizontal faculty view of mental architecture is attributed to Chomsky, who says, a horizontal faculty is a functionally distinguishable cognitive system whose operations cut across cognitive domains. On this view, a cognitive process involves faculties such as memory, imagination, attention, sensibility, perception, and so on, which interact in the course of the cognitive processes. Functioning of these faculties is independent of the subject matter of the cognitive process. Faculty of memory on the horizontal view then has the character that does not depend on the content of the memory, but such content-specific faculties that remember events or faces etc. would fail to be horizontal. Now, Fodor proposes vertical faculties, which we may call being organized in a content-specific way. Vertical faculties are domain-specific, they are genetically determined, they are associated with distinct neural structures, and to introduce a new point, they are computationally autonomous. The following subheadings that we are going to talk about in this module are actually properties of these vertical faculties. Input systems as modules. Fodor postulated input systems or analyzers as the terms that access information about the world and present them to the central computational systems of cognitive processes. Input systems for vision would include mechanisms for color perception, analysis of shape, and analysis of three-dimensional spatial relations. And if we were to talk about input systems for audition, it would include detectors for melodic or rhythmic structure of acoustic arrays, voice recognizers, in addition to grammatical computational systems. Moving on to how input systems are domain-specific. Evidence for domain specificity is brought about by perceptual systems that make possible the phonetic analysis of speech, which are different from the perceptual systems that operate for sound in general. Roughly, the very same sound signal that is heard as the onset of a consonant when the context specifies the stimulus to be a speech sound is heard as a whistle or a glide when it is isolated from that speech stream. The data is given in Fodor 1983. Fodor proposes a domain-specific input system for speech perception within the traditionally recognized sensory perceptual system of hearing or audition. The domain-specific input system for speech could be cross-modal. It could involve sight or vision as well as hearing or audition. For example, let us take the McGrook effect. Now, what is this McGrook effect? Suppose you see someone speaking and hear him or her at the same time under laboratory controlled conditions. What you see the person say can influence what you hear to the extent that you are thought to be hallucinating the speech sound. For example, if you listen to an E sound, but the person is rounding their mouth to say an oo sound, you might hear an oo sound instead of an E sound. This is what the McGrook effect is, and this effect is specific to language. A motion picture of a bouncing ball does not produce a bump, bump, bump hallucination in our mental faculties. Another point about input system is that the operation of these systems is mandatory. By this, I mean that you can't hear speech as some noise, even if you would prefer to. Imagine that you are in a room, the door is open, and someone walks past the door. Suppose that he, she is walking past, speaking in a language that you know. Now, you can't help hearing what is spoken as an utterance, no matter how short a stretch of speech falls on your ears. Contrast this with a situation where the person who is walking past is speaking a language unknown to you. You will hear not speech but sounds in that case. If you see a script that's written in a language that you don't know, you will only see symbols there. Contrast this when you see a speech written in language that you know. In that case, you automatically read it. You do not wait and try and not read it. Fodorian view of input systems have the characteristics of reflexes. However, Fodor also concedes that we can unlearn or switch off some of these reflexes. A reflexive phenomenon in perception, like the perceptual constancies, could be, for example, the constancy of color. And what do I mean by constancy of color? A leaf in bright sunlight actually is a different shade or color of green than the same leaf in shade. But we hardly notice this difference. We see both leaves as the same color, as the same shade of green. An artist requires a kind of unlearning or an ability to switch off this automatic processing of the perceptual input that it undergoes. The impressionist artists, to be precise, they accurately depict the same building in different kinds of light, but they have to pay attention to the retinal image rather than to the object that they see. At the very least, they have to undergo a perceptual constancy of colors unlearning to do this. An artist who wants to design a logo has to be able to see the writing system of that language concerned as pure design in order to be able to create a new visual symbol. Moving on to our next topic, there is only limited central access to the mental representations that input systems compute. To see this, let's see a well-known psychological party trick that goes like this. Speaker E says, "Please look at your watch and tell me the time." Speaker S does so. Speaker E then responds, "Now tell me, without looking again, what is the shape of the numerals on your watch's face?" Speaker S stands stumped. He does not know what to respond with. What this trick shows us is that visual information which specifies the shape of the numerals must be registered when one reads one's watch, but from the point of view of access to late report, that information doesn't take. Also, if you observe, it is often hard to remember whether somebody you have just been talking to has a beard or a mustache or wears glasses. Yet, visual information that specifies a beard must be registered and processed whenever you recognize a bearded face. A similar point can be made about language too. Experiments have shown that by the time a sentence is understood, details about its syntax, whether it's an active voice or passive voice, etc., may be lost to the memory. The speed and mandatoriness of an input process are interdependent. The eye blink is a fast response because it is a reflex. Moving on to our next topic, information systems are informationally encapsulated. A well-known visual illusion is that of the Muller-Lyer illusion. The symbols are on your screen. Look at those two lines enclosed in the arrows. Does one line look longer than the other? And if that's the case, which one? Now, a robust effect is seen across people. The first line, which is enclosed by arrows opening outward, seems longer than the second line, which has arrows pointing inward. But this is an illusion. Both the lines are of the same length, and in fact, while drawing this slide, the same line length was copied down below. What's a point of interest for us here is that even after you have been told that what you see is an illusion, you continue to see them as of different lengths. The visual illusion persists regardless of your knowledge or belief. It is as if these two parts of your brain cannot talk to each other. Comparable effects are also seen in language, and for this we see the phoneme restoration effect. Suppose you make a tape recording of the word legislature. You splice or cut away the sounds in this word and replace it with a cough sound of the same length. When you play this tape to a person who knows English, then they would hear the word legislature with no sound missing. They might also hear a cough in the background. What is happening in this case? The illusion of an intact word still persists even when they know and they are told that what has actually been played to them has a sound cut out. This phenomenon is not fully understood, but information from higher processing levels feeds into lower levels of processing. That is, top-down processing affects bottom-up processing. To quote Fodor, 1983, "At least some of the background information at the subject's disposal is inaccessible to at least some of his perceptual mechanisms. Without this encapsulation, we can't watch TV." Because if you see closely, when we watch TV, we stare at a shimmering piece of glass, but our surface perception module tells the rest of our brain that we are seeing real people and real places. Even in the case of a lifelong couch potato, the visual system never learns that television is a pane of glowing phosphor dots, and the person never loses the illusion that there is a world behind the pane. To summarize what we have been talking about in this module, there are instances of neural correlates of the faculty of vision that have been uncovered by animal experimentation. The innate principles of vision are processing principles, unlike language, which is a body of knowledge. Fodor argues from this difference in part that there appear to be two sorts of faculties of mind, which he calls horizontal faculties and vertical faculties. Vertical faculties are instantiated in memory, in vision, and in syntactic decoding and speech perception. They have the characteristic of reflexes. They are fast, they are mandatory, they are selective in the information they pass on to the central systems, and they are informationally encapsulated. A number of interesting phenomena, such as visual illusions, phoneme restoration in speech perception, limits on immediate recall, fast fading memory for the syntax of a heard stimulus, and the automaticity of speech and visual decoding of script, allow us to deduce the existence of vertically modular systems and their characteristics. I hope all the points covered in this module are clear, and this helps in the development of your knowledge about the modularity of mind from a Fodorian aspect. Thank you.